just said, I don't want to pay $2,000.
Did you happen to find your voucher number?
Oh, no. You know, I'm sorry. I forgot.
You hate to just give up on that, but you also...
I know. I was there.
Yeah.
Check.
Check, check, check. Good morning.
Good morning.
In the name of Jesus Christ, welcome to John McMillan Presbyterian Church. We are a community of people who are disciples of Jesus Christ, and it's our mission to provide a way for this community and the community surrounding us to know, glorify, and serve God. And it's our hope and our prayer that are gathering here in the sanctuary this morning, and those who are gathering at home will be brought into God's presence with this worship service. I have some announcements that I want to share with you this morning before we get started. First of all, I know a lot of people are looking for their year-end giving statements for 2021. If you have given checks or cash to the church in 2021, you will be receiving your year-end report by the last week of January. Also, if you are, and you'll be receiving that from the finance chair of the church, if you have given through GivePlus or the QR code or through the church website, that report will be coming to you by way of email from the Presbyterian Foundation the last week of January. So that information will be coming out in the very near future. Also, there are an awful lot of people who are using our online giving, people from the congregation using the GivePlus app on their phones, going to the church website, or using the QR code. I need to announce that the GivePlus app is being discontinued as of January 31st, but being replaced by something else, and there will be lots more information that we will share with you about that next week as the information comes in from the Presbyterian Foundation. That is an excellent way to give to the church. It's also an excellent way to support the Presbyterian Foundation, so look forward to receiving that information next week at the worship service. There are many visitors who have been joining us, either in the sanctuary or online, who have expressed an interest in becoming members of our congregation. If you are one of them, or know somebody who is one of them, please contact the church office and let us know of your interest so that we can schedule a new members class sometime in early 2022. Because of the pandemic and the increased Omicron and Delta variant infections, we have postponed Children's Church for a week. It will begin, hopefully, next Sunday, January 16th. We have also postponed the first Kids Club and Youth Group celebrations for 2022. They were going to begin this Wednesday, January 12th, but instead will begin on January 19th, the good Lord willing, and the creeks don't rise and the COVID variant doesn't overtake us all. Because of the amazing things that we do with our phones and our computers, like scheduling things and using something called the recurrent scheduler, and because there are some of us who don't use that very well, there was some confusion with regard to the brown bag Bible study and the after-dinner Bible study, and so I want to clarify that. The brown bag Bible study meets at noon on the first and third Wednesdays of the month. My recurrent enter button was every other week, which of course was not correct. The after-dinner Bible study meets at 7 o'clock on the second and fourth Tuesdays of the month. All of those are meeting here at the church, currently planned, and will begin on January 25th for the after-dinner Bible study and the first Wednesday in February for the brown bag Bible study. Again, the good Lord willing, and we're not overtaken by the COVID pandemic. Other announcements. In the bulletin this morning, and you'll probably be seeing them on the screens, I don't know if that we're going to get them up there or not, you will find the bios of all of the people being ordained and installed as church officers this week. The elder bios and deacon bios are in the bulletin, so please take a look at them and introduce yourselves, if you don't know them, to the people who will be ordained and installed today at the worship service. And so we also want to offer our prayers this morning for the people who show up in our directory on the alphabetical basis. We're praying for Gabriella, Alex, and Isabella Taylor, Amy and Buck Thornton, Walter and Marjorie Till. Oh, here's a good couple. Karen Timko and Jeff Tyndall, Karen and Steve Timpona. We also have new joys and concerns that we want to share with the congregation. First of all, we want to offer prayers for Rosemary Eller, whose cancer has returned, and we'll be getting more information about her circumstances this week. We're also praying prayers of sympathy for the family and friends of Pat Farley, who passed away this past week. Viewing will be at the Paul Henney Funeral Home today from 3 o'clock to 8 o'clock. There will be another viewing tomorrow morning here in the sanctuary from 9:30 to 10:30. Her funeral service will be here in the sanctuary tomorrow at 11 o'clock. We're also praying for Gladys Morris, who is Jim Heinerman's sister, who was recently in an accident and suffered a broken hip. We're also praying for Sue Pearson, whose cancer has returned and has decided not to seek further treatment and has entered into palliative care. We're praying for our church secretary, Leslie Bogdan, who is suffering from COVID. We're praying for Alec Little, son of Emily Little, who is suffering from pneumonia. And we also have the prayers and concerns and joys that we have listed for the past several weeks for you to review and add to your prayer list. And now we will see a video of thanks for our Angel Tree gifts to the youth at Duquesne. If you look in the bulletin, you will see that we gathered 65 coats and numerous hats, gloves, and other clothing items that we can send down to Duquesne to keep the kids warm. And now let us worship the living God.
Stand to join me for the call to worship. I am with you, says the Lord.
We do not fear.
I have called you by name.
We do not fear.
You are mine.
We are not afraid.
Every gate of war.
Please be seated. Ever ready with cleansing love, God invites our confession, offering mercy and strength so that we may start anew. In the waters of baptism, O God, you have cleansed us and claimed us. Forgive us for refusing your grace. Forgive us for rejecting your name. We have followed our own paths and have led us far from you. Help us to live into our baptisms, to trust that we need you, for you have marked us as your own, loving us without limit. Wash us with your love again, that with clean hearts we might go to the way of Jesus. The love of God flows ceaselessly. The mercy of God never ends. This is the good news.
There are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit who gives those gifts. There are different ways of serving God, but it is the same Lord who is served. God works through each person in a unique way, but it is God's purpose that is accomplished. To each is given a gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together, we are the body of Christ, and individually, we are members of it. We are called into the church by Jesus Christ by baptism, and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is a common calling, to be disciples and servants of our Lord. Within the community of the church, we are called to particular service. Some are called as deacons. Others are called as elders. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring that his ministry continues among us, providing for ministries of caring and compassion in the world, ordering the governance of the church, the preaching of the word, and administering of the sacraments. And so, representing the one holy Catholic and apostolic church, the session of John McMillan Presbyterian Church will today ordain Susan Zierley and Devin Serena. If you are present, please come over here. We will also ordain, as elders of John McMillan Presbyterian Church, Chris Altmeyer. Chris, would you please come forward? The session also installs to active service those who have been previously ordained, deacons Dan Zierley and Tony Sulkowski. And elders Joe Smith and Cheryl Davies. Can spread out a little bit. Thank you. So I have to ask you these what we call constitutional questions from the Presbyterian Church USA. And please answer as I ask you these questions. Each of you, do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him, Lord of all and head of the church? And through him, believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you? Do you accept the scriptures in the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you? Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by these confessions as you lead the people? Do you and will you?
I do and I will.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you? Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you? Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you? Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you? Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you?
I will.
To Tony and Dan and Susan, will you be faithful deacons, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? And to Chris, and to Cheryl, and to Joe, will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you? To the congregation, do we, as members of John McMillan Presbyterian Church, accept these people as deacons and elders chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do we? Do we agree to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church? Do we? Will you pray with me, please? Eternal God, we give you thanks for your steadfast faithfulness to us. In every age, you have called forth leaders to serve you and equip them with your gifts. Among your people Israel, you anointed prophets, priests, and rulers. You called pastors and teachers, bishops, elders, and deacons to build up your church. With Moses, the 70 elders bore the burdens of your people, ministering in the power of your Spirit. Alongside the apostles, deacons cared for all in need and guarded the community's peace. In the church, deacons, elders, and pastors served together so that your whole people might be equipped for ministry and build up into the full unity of Christ. For your servants in every age, O God, and for the Church of Jesus Christ, we give you all thanks and praise. Now I would ask Tony, Susan, and Dan to turn around. And touch the water that reminds you of your baptism. Confirms your call to be deacons in his church. Let us pray for the deacons. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Dan and Tony and Susan, that they may be faithful deacons in the church Give them openness to the Holy Spirit's leading, that they may see and serve wherever there is need. Train them in the school of prayer, that they may express the compassion of Christ for the poor of the poor and the friendless, the sick, the grieving, and the troubled. Equip them with courage to bear the gospel into the halls of power and to communicate your presence and might among all those who are powerless. In everything, give them the mind of Christ, who did not grasp at greatness, but emptied himself to become a servant of your reign. Give them joy in their walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for their work in ministry. And now, Chris and Cheryl and Joe, please approach the water. Touch the water to confirm your call from God to be elders of this church, and as evidence of your commitment to that task. Let us pray for the elders. God of grace, pour out your Holy Spirit on Chris and Joe and Cheryl, that they may be your faithful elders in the church. Give them prudence and sound judgment, wisdom and courage to order the life of the church in obedience to your word. Nourish them in the life of the Holy Spirit, that they may exercise the ministry of discipline and with humility and compassion. Guide them in governance on this session and in every court of the church, that they may be servant leaders following Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve. And give to each his life to set others free. Give them joy in their walk of faith and a sure sense of your abiding presence for their work of ministry. Gracious God, through the waters of baptism, you have claimed us as your own and called us to share in Christ's ministry. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may discern the gifts you have given, calling them from one another, and together use these gifts for the good of all. In obedience to Christ and in the unity of his Spirit, may we proclaim good news, make disciples, be light and leaven, share our bread, offer a cup of cold water, wash one another's feet, make us strong in Christ to live as your people, and show forth your saving love in the world by the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Tony, Dan, Susan, Chris, Cheryl, Joe, you are now deacons and elders in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Be faithful and true in your ministry so that your whole life will bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by him, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth. You are now installed and ordained. Ladies and gentlemen, our newly installed and ordained officers of John McMillan Presbyterian Church. Pray with me, please. Lord, you are the shepherd of every hope. You are the refuge for each wounded heart. You are companion to the lost and forsaken. Amidst all the discordant tones of life, and in its moments of great joy, we come seeking to experience anew the presence of your Spirit, a presence we oftentimes take for granted, or seek only when life spins out of control. We confess, Lord, to the times we are so busy with the ordering of life We fail to pause to hear the secrets of a waterfall or ponder the magnificence of a sand dollar, or fail to renew our own dreams and visions. Great God, we, as we encounter our appointed moments of life, empower us to celebrate its joyous time, finding time to renew our souls, in which we find respite simply to be. And when in moments of vexation, we become mind weary and body bent, we pray for encouragement, healing, strength of body, mind, and soul. We pray too for those who suffer injustice, those who feel they have little to hope for. And we ask that you comfort those whose dawn is shrouded by the night's grief. Please startle us anew, great God, with your Spirit that brings healing from the ashes of our woundedness. May we experience the serendipitous measure of your grace that calls us to live in faithfulness, doing your justice, living your kindness, walking humbly in your sight. And when the path becomes difficult, the journey more than we can bear, may your grace upon grace upon grace bring calm and order to our lives. We pray this through him who is our friend and brother, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us this prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Will you pray with me, please? Lord, we have gathered here this day, here in the sanctuary and out in people's homes, on phones and on computers, and here in person. And though we are not all together, we know you are with each one of us. And so we ask that you touch our hearts and our minds so that we can hear the word the way you would have it heard, so that we can understand the word the way you would have it understood, so we can live the word the way you would have it lived. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, today we are celebrating two special church days, Epiphany Sunday and Baptism of the Lord Sunday. Now, the first question a lot of people ask is, well, what is it with Epiphany? What exactly is an Epiphany? I mean, can we all know what baptism is? But an Epiphany is a sudden manifestation or perception that reveals the essential nature or meaning of something. It's what we might call an aha moment, sudden realization or understanding. And I think most of us, if not all of us, know exactly what that feels like. It can be as simple as figuring out how to use the remote on your television. Aha. It can be as difficult as learning what calculus is all about. Jim. It can be as life-changing as figuring out the purpose of your existence. And sometimes it can be simply amusing. One time I saw a particular epiphany when I was in Vietnam teaching Presbyterian polity to seminarians there. Can you imagine? They actually asked me to do that. I was demonstrating how Presbyterians decide theological issues. And I asked them this question. What does the Bible say about the baptism of clones? Now, I needed a translator. And so the translator looked at me sort of puzzled. And he said, clones? One of my companions on the trip said, tell him Boba Fett. So I said to him, Boba Fett. Oh, Boba Fett! Clone, Boba Fett. See, Boba Fett is a Star Wars character who is a clone. And they all went, oh, Boba Fett, an epiphany, a moment of understanding. It was a great day. We had a lot of fun with that question, but that was the thing that I thought was funniest. There are lots of such moments in the Bible. The one we usually hear about on Epiphany Sunday is the three kings. We just sang a hymn about the three kings this morning. Searching for the newborn king, they recognize Jesus as that king and worship him. It is an aha moment for them. They realize that the Savior has been born. But we also hear about it in today's scripture reading, which comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 3, various verses. Listen to and hear the word of the Lord. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, and Herod was ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming the baptism of repentance for forgiveness of sins. As people were filled with expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus had also been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." Jesus was about 30 years old when he began his work. Here is an epiphany of monumental proportions. It was the result of a baptism, Jesus' baptism. So let me set the stage. John the Baptist is out in the wilderness looking for and acting like a prophet, which is what he was because he had received the word of the Lord. We don't see a description of what he's wearing in Luke, but we see it in other passages of Scripture. He wears camel's hair clothing with a leather belt, and he eats locusts and honey. Yum. And what is his prophetic message? Prepare the way of the Lord. And here is how you do that, folks. You repent of your sinful life and get baptized so that your sins will be forgiven. Now, what is this baptism that John proclaimed and encouraged? Well, you need to understand that the Hebrew Scriptures talked about baptism in several contexts. The common theme was that one had to be clean, purified, in order to enter into God's presence. To be permitted to stand in the presence of God, one had to undergo a ritual cleansing, which was a ritual baptism. The Essenes, John was one of them, believed that in order to pronounce the name of God, literally, in order to pray, one had to be pure. And so each one of them underwent ritual baptism every morning. Sort of like cleaning oneself up before you're having a conversation with God. This was pretty common because baptismal pools were common around the temple so that people could immerse themselves before going in to perform a sacrifice. And they were even found in people's homes, where bathing in the baptismal waters assured that one was free of ritual impurity. It was used as a sign of obedience to God. But the thing about John's baptism is it was different from all of this. It didn't fit into any of these known rituals. In fact, people have been debating where his baptism came from since it was written about in the Scriptures. It was something new. It was prophetic. People were confessing that they had not lived godly lives. They were committing to change their ways. And then they were immersed in the River Jordan. And that was John's baptism. But John said there would be another coming, another prophet, another person who was going to come along that was even greater than him and more powerful. The one who would baptize not with water, but with the Holy Spirit. The one whose sandal John was not fit to touch. And he, John, knew who that was. It was going to be Jesus. He knew that because Jesus was his cousin. And Jesus came along and was baptized. And one of the great mysteries of the Gospels is, why was Jesus baptized? Why did Jesus want to be baptized? John's baptism was all about repentance and purification. Well, Jesus needed none of that. Right? Jesus was sinless. He was the incarnate God. What did Jesus have to confess, repent from, and be cleansed of? Nothing. Yet Jesus' baptism is of such significance that it is in all four Gospels. And in fact, in two of them, it is the first thing in the Gospel. Neither the Gospel of Mark nor the Gospel of John have birth stories. They're evidence of Jesus' incarnation status comes at his baptism. It's when he begins his ministry, according to Luke. Now, in Matthew, we get some detail about what this must have looked like when Jesus showed up to be baptized. John was puzzled. He was confused. He knows that he is second fiddle and is waiting for Jesus to show up to take the lead. And then Jesus shows up and says, "Hey, John, you need to baptize me." "John, why do I need to baptize you, Jesus? You are the child conceived by the Holy Spirit, right? You are the one who has come to change everything, right? You are the one who brings the kingdom of God, right? Heck, you are the kingdom of God, aren't you?" And Jesus responds, "Relax, John. I'm not here for the repentance of sins. I have none. I am here to join the community of humanity. I'm here to join your community, those who need forgiveness, those who need to be reconciled to God, the people I have come to serve and save. And so I am now, John, emptying myself out and becoming fully human. And to do that, I do need to be changed. I am no longer the carpenter from Nazareth. I am now the Messiah. My baptism, John, will be my anointing. My baptism, John, is my ordination. My baptism, John, is my installation, my acceptance of God's call. This is where my work begins, John." And still, John is unsure. He baptizes Jesus. Then the epiphany of epiphanies. The heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in body form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased." One wonders if John took a step back and said, "Eureka," or "Aha," because that was an epiphany. Jesus accepted the messianic call and had been blessed by God when he did it. And all this happened when Jesus was touched by the baptismal water. Are you experiencing any kind of epiphany today? Have you experienced any kind of epiphany? Jesus' epiphany occurs when he is baptized. It was his answer to the call. His answer was yes. The people needed someone to lead them into the kingdom of God, someone to care for them when needed care. And Jesus was going to be that guy. That's what he was born to do. But he still had to agree to it, and he did at his baptism. And God was pleased, and then Jesus was off on his mission. And that's a really good lesson, I think, for epiphany and for the baptism of the Lord Sunday, because it demonstrates how the two are truly tied together. That it is also particularly important and appropriate for the Sunday when we are ordaining and installing church officers. What does it mean to be ordained? Being ordained is to be admitted into the leadership of the church. We ordain deacons, we ordain ruling elders, and we ordain ministers of word and sacrament. All of these people go through a process whereby they are called by God to lead, to be servant leaders, to be like Jesus. We feel a call from God to do something. And then in John McMillan Presbyterian Church, get a call from the nominating committee. And the nominating committee's call to you is actually, you know, we laugh, because one of the ways we used to do it here was we used to send out a letter a couple of weeks before you were going to get that call. And for a lot of people, the only thing that letter did was tell them that they better not be home when that call comes in 2 weeks from now. But now you don't get the letter, you just get the phone call. But that phone call, even though we can laugh about it, is not just a call from the nominating committee. It's a confirmation to you that God is asking you to serve in a particular way. And then, what we did today, or actually what we did last November, we have a congregational meeting. The nominees who have accepted the nominations come before the congregation, and we elect them, which is further confirmation that they have been called by God, and it's also confirmation that they have accepted that call. And then we come here today. The six people who stood before you, deacons and elders. And typically on Sundays when we ordain and install these people, we call them up. And then we call up all the people who have been ordained as elders, because once you're ordained as an elder, you're always an elder. Once you're ordained as a deacon, you're always a deacon. But when we usually do that, we call all those people forward and we touch the person to let them feel the Spirit move through us into them, and so they can experience what it feels like to respond to God's call and be approved by the people who have served before them. We didn't do that today, I think for obvious reasons. But what I did do today was I asked them to touch the baptismal water. They've all been baptized, but to go over and touch the baptismal water one more time to remind them of their baptism and to also demonstrate that this is also when Jesus was ordained and installed through baptism. And so they had a chance to touch water, and perhaps in that way they had an opportunity to feel the Holy Spirit descend on them the way it descended on Jesus when he was baptized, accepting the call. So what do we do when we ordain people as ruling elders? Well, we ask them to do several things. They have responsibility to provide that the word of God may be truly preached and heard. They are to provide that the sacraments might be rightly administered and received. They are to nurture the covenant community of disciples of Christ. They are to guide the congregation to be witness of God's sovereignty, sovereign activity in the world, so that the congregation becomes a community of faith, hope, love, and witness, and a blessing to the community around us. For those who come to serve as deacons, their responsibility is this: to be compassionate witnesses and servants to the congregation, sharing in the redeeming love of Jesus Christ to the poor, the hungry, the sick, the lost, the friendless, the oppressed, those burdened by unjust policies and structures, and anyone else in distress. And both of these, once it occurs, are permanently ordained. Their ordination continues all their life. It doesn't end with the end of their service. They continue on as elders and deacons. But such an understanding of what these people have undertaken might feel a bit overwhelming, but we need to be at peace when we accept these calls. First, we are promised a couple of things. First, that Jesus will be with us to the end of the age. So at least until the end of your 3-year term. He also promises to send the Spirit to guide you so that you will not be alone. But there's another thing that you have when you become elders and deacons of John MacMillan Presbyterian Church. You have this congregation to support you, to respect you, to follow your lead. And this community of faith today, here in this room and at home, have agreed to be led by you, to pray for you, to support you while you do the things that will push us to be better, and so that we can know, glorify, and serve God. And so after this service today, baptismal water will still be here. And I ask that anybody who's ever been ordained as a deacon or elder in this congregation, take a moment, maintain your good social distance. Come on up and touch the water. And maybe you'll be reminded of that call that you felt so long ago. That call that you answered with a profound yes, and that you served as God's servant leader. And when you do that, it's my hope and prayer that you will feel God's presence and you will experience God's pleasure and you will know that you are not alone. And then the session meeting is the third Tuesday of the month, and there's a deacon's meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Amen. I'll do that.
Thank you.
please join me in our affirmation of faith? God's sovereign love is a mystery beyond the reach of the human mind. Human thought ascribes to God superlatives of power, wisdom, and goodness. But God reveals divine love in Jesus Christ by showing the power in the form of a servant, wisdom in the folly of the cross, and goodness in receiving sinful men and women. You may be.
There is only one Lord and God, from whom all things come and from whom we live. Let us offer our lives to the Lord. We praise and thank you, Lord God, for the majesty of your work, the wisdom of your word, and the generosity of your grace. Let the gifts of our lives bear witness to your goodness and mercy, your faithfulness and justice, and your steadfast love for all. Amen.
Like the fifth.
I will make the darkness bright.
The water is still here. It is the baptismal pool of our church. It is water that has touched each one of you. So I ask if you want to, after the service, come up and remind yourself of the original call that God sent to you before you even knew it. And remember that call. And remember that baptism. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.